Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Amber Huff, and on behalf of the organizers, they include myself, Patrick Huff, and Salima Tazmir, I want to thank you all for being here this evening. I am a research fellow at the Institute of Development Studies and the STEP Center. I'm also part of Brighton Kurdistan Solidarity and part of the broader Kurdistan Solidarity Network in the UK. Again, welcome. A couple of things before we start. The panelists will be being filmed, but we're not going to be filming once they've stopped talking, so you can feel free during question and answer, knowing that it's not going to be recorded. It will be live streamed from the IDS, the Institute of Development Studies, Facebook page, but also it'll be available through the Brighton Kurdistan Solidarity Facebook page, and we'll be putting it out on Twitter as well. So if you want to share the live stream of the panel, please do so, and you can find it on those sites. I'm going to give a brief introduction and then hand over the microphone, as you will, which isn't working right now. So, but I'm going to hand it over to our chair, Dr. Cameron Matan, to govern the rest of the panel. In the past 4 years, in the context of the bloodiest war of the 21st century and following the retreat of the Syrian state from the northern part of the country, the Rojava Revolution has involved the implementation of a new form of non-state governance called democratic confederalism. For those of you who aren't familiar with democratic confederalism, it's a really transformative model based on bottom-up confederated democracy across sectors of society through linked people's assemblies. Women's liberation, the notion of sustainable ecological society, a sustainable cooperative economy, and ethnic pluralism are among its pillars. A fundamental idea underlying democratic confederalism is that social and ecological crises are two sides of the same coin, and any worthwhile solution must aim to reconcile them in practice. Despite its influence on social movements seeking to enact emancipatory projects around the world in recent years, the radical democratic, feminist, and ecological project in Rojava has always faced seemingly insurmountable challenges on the ground. It was implemented amidst the violence of the Syrian civil war, in spite of aggression from Turkey, and since then Rojava's volunteer people's defense units and women's defense units, the YPG and the YPJ, have been engaged in an all-out war of self-defense against the so-called Islamic State, or Daesh, in northern Syria. In early 2018, the Turkish state's long policy of violent suppression against Kurdish people took on a new intensity. Turkey, backed by retrained members of jihadist groups assembled under the banner of the defunct Free Syrian Army, launched the Orwellian-named Operation Olive Branch, a brutal air and ground invasion across the borders of Turkey and Afrin, one of the founding cantons of Rojava, now called the Democratic Confederation of Northern Syria. Until Turkey's invasion, Afrin had been one of the most peaceful regions in Syria, offering shelter to tens of thousands of refugees since the collapse of the Syrian state in 2012. With Turkey's capture of Afrin City this March, its authoritarian president made clear his true aims, to eradicate the Kurdish presence from regions bordering Turkey. Turkey has proceeded to escalate the invasion through ethnic cleansing and so-called demographic replacement. In this context, news coming out of Rojava, Western Kurdistan, or Northern Syria, however you know it, is often difficult to obtain. Since the founding of the Democratic Confederation of Northern Syria, delegations organized jointly by members of the Kurdish diaspora and members of the international solidarity community have been an important way to document and communicate about transformations and challenges on the ground. Tonight's event features speakers from several such delegations, including very recent ones involving British Union leaders and UK-based academics. The speakers have visited communities and projects in Rojava and discussed progress and challenges with political leaders and everyday people. They've come here tonight with updates and new insights and analyses into successes and challenges facing the project of democratic confederalism that continues to evolve on the ground. The current situation represents a crossroads, an intense example of the sorts of contradictions that are emerging at the current political conjuncture all around the world. It also exemplifies in many ways how struggles in northern Syria, like emerging struggles around the world, can be seen as one between fundamentally competing, starkly different visions of the future. That represented by the forces of reaction associated with the wider authoritarian term that many have noted in the global political order, versus that reflected in emerging movements articulating emancipatory alternatives to social and environmental domination, pervasive insecurities and violence. So before handing over to the chair, I would just like to note that we'll be taking up a donation for Hevesor, the Kurdish Red Crescent, which is providing relief to injured and displaced people in Afrin at great risk to their own lives. So if you'd like to donate to Hevesor, there is a collection bowl in the foyer at the info stall. There are also books and lots of information available. And finally, I'd like to thank our speakers, who will be introduced in a moment, and all the groups that have endorsed or co-sponsored or helped publicize this event. This includes the STEP Center and the Institute of Development Studies at the University of Sussex, the Peace in Kurdistan campaign, the Freedom for Ocalan campaign trade union group, Brighton Kurdistan Solidarity, Brighton Anti-Fascists, and the Kurdistan Students Union of the UK. But of course, many, many more groups have shown their support by circulating information about the event. Thanks as well to everyone again who's helped spread word and has shown up tonight. It's incredibly important that we show solidarity with struggles for democracy, life, women, and freedom, and ecological society in Kurdistan and also all around the world. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Kamran.
Thanks, Amber. Hi, everyone. My name is Kamran Mati. I teach international relations at the University of Sussex, and I have an interest in Kurdish politics and some exposure to Kurdish liberation movement in Iranian part of Kurdistan in the 80s and early 90s, which is why I think I'm chairing this session as well. I will immediately start by introducing our speakers so that we have enough time for discussion. I will start from my far left, Janet Beer. Janet is a translator of a number of works on Rojava and Kurdish movement more generally. She translated the first book-length study of Rojava's revolutionary experience, translated from German into English. And I understand she has just published another book, the memoir of Sakina Johnson, one of the founding figures of Kurdistan Workers' Party, whose ideas and politics is very influential in Rojava Revolution as well. Then we have Lloyd Rasmussen on my immediate left. Lloyd is a labor MP for Brighton and Kemptown, and he's also been to Rojava as part of a delegation. A month ago, so it's very recent. I should have also mentioned Janet has also been to Rojava as part of an academic delegation in 2014. Then we will have Simon Dobbins from the Unite Labour Union. Simon, you have also been to Rojava, right? And yes. And finally, Elif Sarajan. We had a dispute over how to pronounce her surname, but we resolved it very peacefully. and we decided it means yellow life, which is perfect, I guess, for the season. So Elif is a postgraduate student at London School of Economics, LSE in London. And she's also, are you a member of the Kurdish, Kurdistan Union?
Students
Union, yes. Yeah. And she has also been to Rojava. So our speakers basically report back from their observations and findings in Rojava and hopefully shed a kind of new light on Rojava's development and give us a first-hand account of the challenges and the successes which the Rojava Revolution has achieved in Rojava. And I think, in addition to all the important points Amber made, I think at this particular time it's really important to learn and be exposed more to Rojava, because the entire region is boiling with change in Turkey, in Iran, in Iraq, as probably you know from recent developments. And Rojava's experience will have really vital implications, if it's successful, for those countries, because in each and every of these countries there is long-standing national questions, the problem of ethnic tension and kind of cultural hierarchies which have been imposed by nation states formed in the early 20th century in these countries. So at the same time, Rojava's success also partly depends on its expansion and branching out of Syrian Kurdistan or Rojava into neighboring countries. So there is a mutual dependency and beneficial kind of relation between Rojava's movement and other branches of Kurdish movement and other minorities movement in the region. So without further ado, therefore, I hand over to our first speaker, Janet. Our speakers will have roughly 10 minutes. We want to maximize the time for input from the floor, so I hope our speakers stick to the 10 minutes. At 12 minutes, I will give you a warning, and hopefully we'll stick to the time. So, Janet.
Thank you, Cameron. As Cameron has mentioned, I've participated in an academic delegation that went to Rojava in late November, early December of 2014. So I'm going to speak first because I'm going to lay out the impressions I saw there and to give you kind of an overview. The members of subsequent delegations will be able to maybe let us know how things are changed and how things are the same, but to sort of be the foundation for the others. So in December of 2014, this was about 2.5 years after the Rojava Revolution of July 2012. It was less than a year after the adoption of the social contract and the formation of the democratic autonomy of self-administrations. At the time of the Rojava Revolution, efforts had been made to implement democratic confederalism, to create institutions of grassroots democracy, councils, assemblies, committees, and they had become more and more the institutions of the self-government of northern Syria. It was a remarkable innovation and an effort to implement an ideology of democracy. and in January of 2014, there was a great deal of frustration with the fact that the international powers were not taking Rojava seriously. They saw themselves as modeling a new way forward in Syria. They were trying to get admitted to the Geneva Conference, but the powers were all but ignoring them. And so, as was told to me, they decided, okay, if you're not going to invite us, then we're just going to go our way. We're going to declare democratic autonomy. So they, each of the three cantons, as they were then, adopted a social contract, which was in lieu of a constitution, because a constitution is what a state has. But they were trying to create a stateless democracy, so they called it a social contract. It's a contract amongst the people in the society. And it started out by naming all of the different ethnic groups and religious groups in the northern Syrian cantons and naming the official languages, which were threefold, Kurdish, Aramaic, and Arabic. And the social contract was just replete with provisions from human rights treaties from all around the world. It was a remarkable document. They held out hope that their system would be recognized by the powers, but one reason they thought maybe it wasn't was because it was so radical. So they decided to adopt a second layer, a second tier of self-government called the Democratic Autonomy Administrations, which were more like had a traditional state government. They had a legislative council and an executive council, and there would be elections. They were hoping that this effort to conform to a traditional state, although they really didn't seem to take it that seriously, would help get them accepted. But in any case, the basic democratic layer of face-to-face citizens' assemblies and committees, at the time I was there in December, was sort of coexisting with this the DAA tier, and it was sort of unclear how power was going to be divided, how things were shaking down. The the citizens' assemblies wanted to the power to flow from the bottom up, but what happened to the decisions was kind of unclear. I attended a meeting of a commune, a citizens' assembly in Kamishlo, and was very thrilled to see a very rigorous and disciplined participation. People would just speak for a while and then sit down, the next person would speak. It was almost as if they'd been doing this all along. One thing that struck me in addition to this democratic structure was their terminology that they used. Like I said, they used social contract instead of a constitution, which was what a state has. They called their educational institutions academies. That's a term that and a formation that came out of the PKK. Academies were what their movement had, as opposed to universities, which they associated with the state. They called their internal security forces units asayish, which means just internal security, to distinguish them from police, which is what a state has. The police defend the state, the asayish would defend the society. Similarly, the famous YPG and YPJ, those are people's protection units. They don't call them the army, because the army is what a state has. They're the people's protection units and the women's protection units because they serve the society, not the state. The justice system was based also on committees called peace and consensus committees, especially at the grassroots level. The idea was to keep the justice system as localized as possible so that things wouldn't have to go up into upper tier courts. Large committees would handle conflicts between people, and there was a whole second tier of women's committees and councils to resolve issues pertaining to women. Instead of there were prisons, there were still prisons, but the Kurds had been through terrible experiences in prisons, and so their goal was to resolve conflicts, you know, through these committees so that ultimately prisons would disappear. They didn't want to have prisons at all. What else can I tell you? The people that our delegation spoke to were mainly activists who had participated in the revolution itself. They were people from the PYD, people from what was then called Gyakiti Astar, the women's organization that has since been changed. They talked with great hopes and expectations about their revolution, they kept saying, "Tell us what mistakes we've made. Tell us what we're doing wrong." They were very eager for criticism from the outside, for suggestions. It was really, really quite remarkable. There had been no elections yet, despite the commitment to democracy. There had been no elections when I was there, because of the problem of in order to have elections, you have to have you have to know who's there. So a census was still in the process of being planned. So that would still be in the future. As we drove through Jazeera was not yet, it was still separated from what was then called Kobani Canton. Tal Abyad, the places in between Jazeera and Kobani were still in Arab hands and Daesh hands. As we drove through, so I was only in Jazeera, you couldn't get to Kobani. As we drove through, there was wheat monoculture everywhere. This was a leftover from the regime, which had used Jazeera as the breadbasket for all of the rest of Syria. They didn't have, they didn't have a process. They had only just jerry-rigged a wheat processing mill from local materials. The only source of they had oil, but no refineries. So they kind of jerry-rigged some ways to produce diesel. We were told that the monocultures, they wanted to try to break up that monoculture and have more diverse crops, but that was nothing like that had really, we didn't see anything like that that was happening yet. The economics minister of Jazeera Canton told us that there was a threefold economy. There was the war economy, which was the largest, it took up most of the budget, which came, came from oil, which was sold very, very, very cheaply to the population. And then there was what they called the social economy, which was consisted of cooperatives. They didn't expropriate, the existing enterprises, but the regime had left a lot of, had abandoned not just, you know, the government of the area, but had abandoned lands and infrastructure such that the new polity was left, the new self-government was left to decide what to do with them, and they decided that all new economic entities would be cooperatives. They were building them when we were there in 2014. There was a lot of education being done about what a cooperative is and how to run it. We visited an economics academy which was dedicated to that purpose. There was a very strong emphasis on giving women positions in these cooperatives, giving them employment in those cooperatives so that they could, for the first time, have their own income. There was an emphasis on families of martyrs also having a prior claim on positions in the economies. There was a commitment everywhere to the principle of no revenge taking. You know, the Kurds have been oppressed by the Syrian Arab Republic for so long that there was a great, one might have expected that now that the Kurds had a modicum of power, that they would, it was payback time. Every place we went, people said no payback, no revenge taking. We are trying to model an inclusive, an ethnically and religiously inclusive society for the rest of Syria and for the rest of the Middle East. So it's very important to restrain any, you know, elements that might want to go rogue and commit violence against another ethnic group. One thing that was not under a work in progress when I was there was the women's units. This is the use of women as fighting forces. The commitment of the PKK to the gender equality was by then in the second generation, maybe even the third generation. They had been pioneered by a woman named Sakina Johnsis in the 1970s, who had managed to make herself into an autonomous woman leader of the Kurdistan movement. This is in the 1970s when you could barely even mention Kurdistan in Turkey, and when the cisgender system insisted that women had to be married, they had to go from their father's house to a husband's house. That was it, full stop. She managed to extricate herself from that, a story that's told in this book that I just translated, volume one of her memoirs, which covers her life up until 1979, explains in great detail how she hacked it, basically, if I can use a word that she would never use. But she managed to find ways to hack the system, to make herself into a someone through the force of her own character, through some lucky breaks, through some circumstances that worked in her favor. She was able to become a woman leader in the Kurdish movement, such that women today in Rojava look back and consider her their foremother. And she's the one that pioneered this and made it easier, so that now, you know, young women in other parts of the Kurdish areas have a force to flee to. They have an alternative way of life. They're not stuck in marriage. And she was the one that pioneered that. So this is the way I'm inserting the backstory of this book into it's her life is part of the backstory of Rojava. So I think I'm going to stop there. We'll be happy to answer any questions, but pass the torch to more recent information. Thank you.
Is it working?
It's not working.
Okay,
I think
it's a small it's fine. So Simon and I went, feels like less than a month ago, but it was actually the beginning of April that we went on a delegation trip. And we felt that the time was right, partly because the corridor between Iraq and northern Syria had been opened up. Daesh had effectively been defeated, and we were more able to cross. We were able to get the Northern Syrian Federation was effectively united as one piece of landmass at that point that we were able to then cross over it and see the areas. And of course, we had had Afrin, and that was big in our minds. And those things happening, the danger of ongoing aggression of Turkey was a moment that we felt this was the right time and place. I mean, there was a secondary issue of actually northern Iraq and the Iraqi Kurdistan region, of which they just had a referendum, and the backlash from the Iraqi government. I won't talk much about that tonight, although there is an interesting story, I think, to be had there about what is happening as well. But the aim, I think, from us was to be able to show solidarity, but also to come back with some practical outcomes of what we, as the as Britain, collectively, myself as a parliamentarian in the Commons, and my colleague as a parliamentarian, Lord Glasman, in the Lords, and as trade unionists, we could do together to push the British government and British people's understanding of what is happening in Rojava and what we can do to support and help. And I think what we saw was a society being built from the ground up. And when we went to see one of these parish communities, these communes, whatever word you wish to use, and I think the word actually can be used relatively interchangeably in that respect, what you saw was communities that had come together, and we asked them, how did you organise? Literally gone down the street, spoken to neighbours, and started to build local meetings and committees to run the local streets. And you're talking about four, five, six streets together. Mm-hmm. And the way that they have developed accountability is something that is far off any accountability that we have here. So not only do you have people who are the co-chairs of each of the respective committees, and there is a committee around women's rights and women's empowerment, there's a committee around education, there's a committee around kind of civil protection, and there are a number of different committees, each of course headed by two people, one who must be a woman, one who must be from a minority ethnic background from that community. And that diversity, I think, was important for us in understanding this is not just a Kurdish project, actually, in northern Syria and Rojava. It is, of course, led by many of the inspirations and the ideas of Öcalan and others. But actually, it is a wider project around that democratic confederalism that has brought everyone in. And one of the things that you sometimes hear from people who haven't, I think, been or seen, is that it is somehow trying to replace one ethnic majority or rule with another ethnic majority rule. And that is not what we saw at all. That is not what the reality seems to be on the ground. In fact, the reality is a multi-ethnic, multi-gender kind of governance at the very local level. And at the local level, you have regular meetings where all the community can come and hold their committees to account, can effectively censure their committees, and can change over their representatives at their will. Not only at the annual meeting, where they are all up for grabs, but regularly, throughout the year and throughout the months. And those regular, sometimes monthly, sometimes less regularly, meetings were open for all, but actually a number of people committed to going regularly to push the issue forward. And I was actually quite taken aback by that. And the reason that I used parish earlier on is because I am reminded of, to some extent, what those very original concepts of the parish meeting was meant to be. Ignore the religious part, ignore the step up. But the concept of the parish meeting in small villages to some extent, in Britain was originally meant to be that anyone in the village could turn up and they could talk about the organisation of their village and there would be committees formed. And to some extent, that has been completely swept away as the state has centralised power here. And what they're trying to replicate is that some of those forms of democracy that have been forgotten almost completely in the West, but actually not just replicate them, do them in an improved and better manner. And so that was, I think, rather impressive. But it also what we saw is a society that had struggled through war, and a people, I think, that felt let down. Let down that they expected some help, more practically from us, their allies, but also let down that actually people still didn't really talk about them as a solution to the wider issues of Syria and the region. And actually, when I returned, unfortunately, the day that we were leaving, the day after, of course, this chemical issue arose. And in Parliament, of course, I arrived back and this was the hoo-ha. And there was a debate held in Parliament about finding long-term political solutions to Syria, because Sitz Piqua worked so well that Britain should draw some more lines on the map. But that, of course, is a sensible idea that we should at least have an idea of how we could positively play a role. And not once was the Northern Syrian Federation mentioned in Parliament. In those debates that were heated and discussed, and people on all sides saying, well, we've got the solution. And I, of course, stood up and mentioned it. And people, oh, yes, good idea. Anyway, moving on about the... And this idea that they are a footnote rather than actually part of the key solution, and I say solution cautiously because I don't think there's a solution that can be brought from the top down, but they are a solution from the bottom up. And to ignore that, we ignored it at our peril. When we saw some of the fighters who had been fighting Daesh and how they said they had the resources and the ability, they had the resources and the need to seek medical treatment in Britain. And would we allow them to come and seek medical treatment to repair soldiers who had fought? And the answer was from the British state, no, you're not welcome. We don't know, we can't work out the wheat from the chaff, we can't work out whether you're terrorist or not, so it's better just to say no to war. And these are people that were meant to be our allies and have actually been fighting a fight, not just for us, but for all humanity to some extent, with the fight particularly from Daesh. And fundamentally also a feeling of letdownness from what happened with Afrin and an allowance of Turkey to walk in there and to impose extremist Islamist forces who are not quite ISIS, but are not, in some respects, far off. And how we have set back and allowed that, we as Britain and the West, has set back and allowed that to happen. So a feeling of being let down. And under all that betrayal, under all that feeling, did they feel any anger or resentment? Not one bit. Not one bit did I get. In fact, to some extent, I felt like there was almost a false feeling of, no, you're still our friends, you're still our allies, we still want to work with you. And I felt incredibly ashamed as someone from the UK who sits in the British Parliament about how we had effectively allowed people to fight our fight and then abandon them at the time of need. So the determination was to see not only how the social movement had organised, but also how some of those political issues in terms of the fight that goes on could be issues raised of awareness. And of course, since we have come back, we have raised these issues with the minister. In fact, I have a meeting. We've arranged just a meeting with the minister now for me and Lord Glasgow to sit down and go through the recommendations with them. But every time, it is a thank you very much for your useful input. We want nothing really more to do with this, and we even. even see that to an extent here in this city, where the radicalization threat of the YPG and the YPJ is now included in the local prevent program along the same line, on the same line in the document as ISIS, which is, my view, is a disgrace, but actually shows what the British state thinks about this, and it is not based on reality. And you speak to our ambassadors on the ground, I mean in Iraq and in Turkey, who cover this area, and they have no ability to be able to determine who is really fighting the right fight and who is not. And so it just gets all put into one pot. So the importance was for us to meet some of these people and to talk about issues that were important. And the reality is that whilst fascism of Turkey and of, to some extent, of Russia and Syria has an air force, the People's Revolution does not. And whilst they are confident they can win that fight, hearts and minds and the physical battle on the ground, what they can't win is an air warfare. And so there needs to be immediate action to protect them, to save them, to prevent further airstrikes and air domination. And whether that is a no-fly zone that is agreed by the Security Council, or, as no one has yet tried, but is legally possible through the General Assembly, and I have no idea why it has not been tried by the British government, but there is legal precedent for doing it via the General Assembly rather than the Security Council when permanent five vetoes, so it can be done. Or whether it's actually, to some extent, via deals or unilateralism. I actually almost don't care, because what needs to happen is people need to be protected, and that protection is to prevent something happening, and that is to prevent the bombing of towns. And what we saw when we went to Kaboni was a city that had been rebuilt, and we asked, where in this city is the original things that have not been obliterated? They took us to one street, about four houses in it. And we said, so where's the rest of the street? Where's the rest of the original? Said nothing was left. Everything was obliterated and to the ground, or effectively to rubble. But actually, I'm not saying that there was nothing there. What you saw was a huge amount of building work, a huge amount of buildings resurrected from the ground upwards, and effectively the city has been reborn, and it has not been reborn through some state planning, and it's not been reborn through some on the other side, some capitalist free enterprise. It has been reborn through people and communities coming together and arranging for their streets and their houses and their neighbourhoods to be reborn. To some extent, although I always am worried about using this phrase, it is a true third way between Stalinism and capitalism. It is a true socialism, not a pretend third way. It is a true third way, which is an actual way that has prosperity for us. And actually, I think, shows many things that we can do, societally wise, in terms of how women have been involved, but also through the rebuilding of local communities. But many of those communities in Kaboni now were taking people from Afrin as refugees. And they were having to buy off the black market food parcels from the World Food Programme. They were having to buy off the black market tents or other equipment from the refugee agency. These are goods that British people and people from around the world have contributed to by providing money to the UN or to other aid agencies. They're not getting there. And they're not getting there because, of course, Britain and the UN don't really want things to get there. We look at education, and one of the questions that I asked while I was there is, how is education organised? And there is, of course, organisation of education in the communities. And they have got these, as you have mentioned, these academies, these university styles that they are establishing. But in some areas, it's still very fragile. There is very little resource to pay for the upkeep, building, and continuation of education. Now, the UN has a fund for education, but it only gives that money to states. you have to be a registered student to receive money from the Global Partnership for Education. And so they are not entitled to any of those resources. Britain gives, quite right, £300 million per period, about £75 million a year to that programme, but not a penny can go. So one of the things that we have done, actually, is immediately went, with my colleague Stephen Twigg, who's on the International Development Committee, immediately went to Washington to meet with the programme, and they have agreed that they will develop a system for that money to be released to non-states where they are operating and controlling a certain area of territory. So there are areas that we are able to push, but the problem is the information often doesn't get out there because people are restricted. And where I will finish on is some of you may have seen an article in Guido Forbes, actually, about our trip, which was a pretend leak from the MOD saying that our trip had been utterly reckless and stupid and no one should go. And most of it was lies because we told the Foreign Office and we told the people in authority. We met with the Consul General the day before we crossed over. We met with him on the day back that we got there. They knew about the details of what we were doing. But the reason that article was leaked, and it was leaked by someone in government, was because they want to scare off future people from going. And they want to pretend that there was some huge security risk. Yes, there was the threat of Turkey on the border. Yes, there is the threat that it is, you know, kind of, it's not a peaceful society yet. But actually, in organised delegations, in organised trips, with the correct, proper preparation, like in many parts of the world, it is not something that people should be fearful of. And why it is important to go is to see what is happening on the ground. So things where there are problems with how the UN is doing things, where there are problems about how the UK is doing things, people can then speak out. And actually the authorities would like it that people don't speak out. And so whilst you may have seen that article, what I would urge you to do, what I would urge people to do, is to, if you can, in organised delegations, I don't mean just as a holiday trip, organised delegations, to go and visit, to not only show solidarity, but to be able to take those messages of what people there need, and what they want, and how we can help them, back to Britain when you come back. And I know that we, as the delegation that went, and the organisers of that, are very keen to look at organising with Parliament, and with other academics and other leaders, other trips in the near future, and I hope that we can make those regular, those activities. I said that I would leave it there. I will just say one more thing. I do remember as well, is I ran the Woodcraft Folk for many years in the UK. I was the chairperson. And I remember how we used to do exchanges with young people from Western Sahara, year in, year out, and how we did the same with young people from Palestine. And I think it is also important for us to start to think about how we build that practical solidarity, not just in the face of the Syrian war, but the ongoing face of supporting an area that is really pushing forward the concepts of how communities and states or non-states can organise. And we start to create those links. And I would like to see our youth organisations doing that, and I know that's something that I have fed back to the Woodcraft Folk, but also cooperatives, and I know that there are people here organising cooperative exchanges, but I think we can do that at all levels of society. And to make sure that that Rojavian revolution, that feminist revolution that we saw, and it was highly embarrassing that we were an all-male delegation, and quite rightly it was embarrassing for us, and it was, they pointed it out every time. that is something that we said, well, you know, the problem is you are far more advanced than even we are, and we need to take back some of the learning from how they have built societies from the bottom.
Many thanks to Lloyd Larson Moy for this evocative account of his journey to Rojava. So now I hand over to Fortune Sanders.
So careful stand. I'm used to always sit there. Look, first of all, thanks ever so much to everybody that's organised it, Amber, Salima, Kamala. I think it's really fantastic that this event is taking place here, and it's an honour to be in the same city that Anna Campbell came from and who gave her life so courageously and bravely and fell victim to the type of terrorism that we're seeing everywhere from the Turkish state at the moment. And we've never met, but I know Dirk and Adam, her brother and father, are here, and it's fantastic to have you here. And you know, we all have sent your commiserations and our thoughts and everything, and it's just fantastic to have you here and be in this city as well. So thank you. Look, colleagues, what I just wanted to start with very briefly is just why is a union being involved in the solidarity work with the Kurdish people in all the various areas? And personally, I first became aware of the Kurdish struggle in Germany in the early 90s, and on every May Day march at that time, you'd see the Kurdish block there with the picture of Öcalan and the flags, and very disciplined and marching. And they were always very present, and then I moved to different places and it kind of drifted away a little bit. Always aware of what was going on, but where it really came back into focus again was Kobani in 2014, and I was already working in the union for a long time and looking after the international work. And we'd been following what had been happening in Syria and elsewhere, and to be perfectly frank, it was just such a, I'm tempted to use very bad language, but I won't, outrage to watch what was happening, to watch a city being attacked by ISIS, the brutality and violence that was being meted out, and then to learn that the Turkish state was not only not allowing Kurdish fighters to cross and help from the Turkish side, but they're actually patching up the very bastards that were doing it to the people and sending the weapons in to help them do it. So we issued our first statement then and said it was outrageous, they should allow the Kurdish fighters to cross. And we started to follow it much more closely, what was happening, be more involved. In 2015, I happened to be there for an international union delegation on the very day that the great election happened in June, when the HDP got the breakthrough result there, and people, there was an atmosphere that was quite jubilant and upbeat, but we all know what happened then. That was utterly unacceptable, so it was attacked, the bomb attacks then followed suit, a new election was called and the repression started, and then we saw the horrific, horrific state violence meted out in Diyarbakir and Nuzabin and Mardin, other cities, Kurdish cities in the region as well. I went then with the first delegation we had and saw firsthand what was happening there. And having been to Palestine and Colombia and places like that, you think you're kind of prepared for violent situations. But what we saw there was absolutely horrific, and some of the worst paramilitary gang-style violence that I've ever had the misfortune to witness. So we then built the Freedom for Öcalan campaign and ran through the last couple of years building the Solidarity and the Labour Party, the TUC, and I'm really proud because the TUC is not exactly the bastion of revolution, but we've got a position now calling for the freedom of Öcalan and solidarity with all the Kurdish forces and progressive forces in Turkey, and we've signed them to move things forward. Last year, we had a delegation to the Kurdish areas in Iraq just before the referendum, and then this year we've been with, and I'll take my hat off, Lloyd and Morris, because it ain't easy finding MPs that are prepared to go there and actually take what they perceive as the huge risk and to take the trouble and effort to actually go. So I'm really, really pleased that that you did, Lloyd. But look, we went to Rojava for two reasons. The first one was to try and see on the ground, obviously, what everything that we were hearing as people of the left, as socialists, was fantastic. We wanted to see, is this really happening, and just see with our own eyes. It's always stronger to recount it then. But secondly, probably more important, because we were convinced of that anyway and had heard that, but you want to see it yourselves, but it was this, it was quite simply an act of solidarity as well. We know the area has been in effective isolation and blockaded, And we wanted those people there to understand that they're not alone. And we wanted to send the message that will come with MPs and a member of the House of Lords, and we will get through this, and we will not be stopped from going there and expressing our solidarity and seeing what was happening. We were only there a couple of days. I'm not going to go through the details. You've already heard from Lloyd, and you'll hear more from Elif. But we were in Qamishli and Kobani. For me personally, it was again an honour to be in Kobani after the heroic struggle that had gone on. And I echo what you said, Lloyd, that really the spirit there of defiance and rebuilding is quite fantastic. Really, it is a pleasure to see the way in which they're rebuilding the city, and in such a democratic, inclusive and tolerant way, something we should all, with our type of politics, be proud to be associated with and want to support. We met with all levels of society, as you've heard, with the YPJ, the YPG injured fighters, the commanders and so on, and had a whirlwind tour of the area. It's obviously completely true in terms of the inclusiveness, the tolerance that is there, and the different society that is being built. What I was struck by was a few things. It reminded me very much of what I've already seen in the Kurdish areas in Turkey, to be quite honest, with the co-chairs, with the emphasis on women's participation, the tolerance, and obviously the ideological background is there from Öcalan and from the Kurdish political movement as a whole. Exactly what Erdogan, and it's difficult for me to say his name without saying that bastard Erdogan, has been intent on destroying, because it is everything that challenges him and challenges that type of system that was being built there, and why he's crushed it so viciously, and why he's now focusing attention on Rojava, where exactly the same principles are being put into effect. But what really got me as well is how fragile everything is there. Very, very fragile. When we were in Kobani, Lloyd, the security cordon that we had did not want us to leave the line of destroyed buildings, because the Turkish border is about 70 metres away, and they're still getting snipers, they're still getting occasional bomb attack, grenades thrown and everything, and that shows you how vulnerable everything is. Qamishli is also on the border, effectively, and you can almost feel the Turkish state. Don't forget, we were there just as Afrin was had fallen. I could almost sense the Turkish state waiting, champing at the bit, because they want to get in there, and I have no doubt they want to ethnically cleanse the whole of Rojava, because Turkey is at war with the Kurds, not just in Turkey, but in Rojava, in Iraq, and in everywhere. They are on a racist ethnic war, and make no mistake about that whatsoever. As Lloyd said, it's the problem with Rojava and the fighters that we spoke to there, the problem in Afrin, they were confident they could have held out longer had they had air support, or Turkey had not been allowed to use the Air Force. But against that type of technology, it's virtually impossible, without the proper support on this side, our side of the fence, to resist that. And I say this, it is an out-and-out outrage and disgrace that the international community has stood by and allowed that to happen. And then Theresa May to stand there and talk about legitimate Turkish concerns about Kurdish terrorism, it really makes you want to vomit when you hear her using those sorts of expressions, when you know it's all about selling more arms to the type of neo-fascist or fascist in actuality that is standing behind that. The recommendations that Lloyd mentioned, I think, are the most important thing. We've produced a report, it's going to be printed this week, and we will circulate it to all MPs, members of the House of Lords and so on, as well as the government. This is not easy for the left, and we're going to have to get our heads around this as well. A premature American, UK, French withdrawal from that area will be a bloody disaster. It's not something we like to hear, because we all know the history of American, British imperialism, Iraq, the invasion, all that stuff. But listen, don't kid yourselves. If they suddenly move out of there, that will be the green light for Turkey to move in. Now, that is not to say they should stay there indefinitely and all the rest of it, but right now they should not move, and that was not what people there want. They're absolutely clear about that. The colleagues were telling us what they desperately need there is a no-fly zone to cut out the air support, the air superiority that the Turkish army has got and is used to such devastating effect. If you remember in Iraq during that period, there was a no-fly zone that at least enabled the Kurds in that area to have some degree of stability and peace. The international community needs to act, and it needs to act decisively to condemn Turkey for what it has done, demand the rights of return, and they need to send delegations there to give it the recognition to break the isolation that Rojava has been pushed into. And there's a lesson for us on this side of it, the trade unions and labour movement. We need, without a shadow of a doubt, to raise awareness about what is going on. The British trade union movement has got a bloody proud and good record. We've stood shoulder to shoulder with Cuba in the most difficult times. Our solidarity with the Palestinians is unsurpassed, and we're trying to build that further. We've stood together recently with the Kurds. Historically, we stood together with our brothers and sisters in South Africa and helped defeat the apartheid regime. We've got the experience of building big international movements and having an impact and making a change. And we need to get the delegations out there. We need people to come to more meetings like this, spread it in the union, spread it in the Labour Party, build that movement in the UK and indeed internationally. Because, and I'll finish with this, Chair, I am 100% convinced, any of you that have not read some of the writings of Öcalan, I'd recommend you to do it, because the Kurdish political movement is absolutely essential. It's essential for the Kurds, obviously. It's essential for the people in that region. And where the hell else are we going to get a movement that is championing women's rights and equality and inclusiveness in the region where that has historically been most difficult to achieve and ever bring to fruition? And because of the complexity of that region and the international powers that have all got their spoon in the mix there and their own interest they're pursuing, I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that this is vital for the future of humanity. So we need to get that into our heads. Everything that we hold dear as the left, our values, these people are putting that into practice. They are fighting for it day in, day out, and they are building it in reality. The British and wider international trade union and labour movement has got to wake up to this fact and get on board with it and build the pressure and build the international solidarity with them. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you.
Simon already mentioned, but acknowledging Dirk and Adam being here, the father and brother of Anna Campbell. Everyone who has heard about the sacrifice and the heroism of Anna Campbell knows that she is now a hero for women and revolutionaries all around the world, not just in the UK. So through the memory of Anna, I want to salute and remember all revolutionary martyrs who have made this possible today, and also salute the person, the thoughts of the person who made it possible, Abdullah Öcalan, the Kurdish people's leader, who has been locked up in isolation for 20 years on a Turkish prison island. So I was in Rojava. I came back actually just exactly a month ago, actually, and I was only there for about 2 weeks. So I say only because a revolution that is home to about 4 million people, 2 weeks is nowhere near enough to even begin to really understand what's happening. And I've been an activist of the Kurdish Students' Union, of the Kurdish Women's Movement for some years now, and you think you have an understanding, but when you go there, like, I think it was interesting because a lot of the things, like, I kind of already thought, and the way we organize here, it was very familiar to see.
which it was, I think, is the beauty of the Kurdish movement, where, you know, the way it organizes with its community and with its people, it wasn't so different. So I felt at home in that sense. But some of the things that I will speak about that I got to see, that I had the privilege to experience, I think, you know, true to the, I guess, methods of the Kurdish movement, when I got back, I had to sit down and really have a session of self-criticism with myself to kind of deconstruct some of the approaches I had as someone, as a Kurdish person who was born in London. So we got to go to go all around Qamishlo, all around the Jazeera canton, which includes places like Amuda and Delik, which is where the internationalist commune of Rojava is, which I'll speak a little bit about. So my delegation was an education delegation to try and understand the education system of Rojava. We got to have discussions with educators and teachers at the Rojava University and also the Mesopotamia Academy, which are both based in Qamishlo. We got to go as far west as Minbij. We got to go to Kobane, as Simon and Lloyd also did. We got to go to Raqqa. We got to see Raqqa as well, and to Shengal, where, you know, the which is home to the Yazidis and was also under siege by the so-called Islamic State. Now, I think there's many unique aspects of each of these places, which is certainly one of the beauties of it, because when you're in a place like Qamishlo, it's a really buzzing city, and it's certainly, I guess, if we could call it, kind of the capital of the Democratic Federation of Northern Syria, because it's closest to the Iraq border. That's where most of the, especially education and economic work, is happening. But also, I want to focus a little bit on Minbij, because I think it's certainly one of the most unique cities of the revolution, because the assembly, when we got to meet with the assembly, it was, I think, a true display of exactly what this revolution is trying to achieve, because the assembly really consists of Arabs, Kurds, Turkmens, Caucasians, Christians, Muslims, and they're all in one room. And the most significant person that I got to speak to was an Arab, what he used to be, an Arab tribal leader called Fuad. And I think he was remarkable because I wanted to interview him, and he's probably the best interviewee ever, because I didn't even ask him a question and he just spoke for 20 minutes and stopped. So, and he said all the things that I wanted him to say without me asking any questions. But I did get to ask him one question, which, you know, as an Arab leader, and therefore a part of this assembly in Minbij, what is your message to the Arab people of the world? And he said to me, he of course criticized the Arab states and their complicity and their complacency against the Rojava revolution, but he said, I don't have a message to the Arab people of the world, I have a message to humanity, and everyone must support this revolution. Because when I told him I was a coordinator of the Kurdistan Students Union in the UK, he had said to me, you shouldn't just be organizing Kurdish students, you should also be trying to organize Arab students, which is what prompted me to ask him that question. And his answer, for me, it gave me so much hope, because you're a Minbij, you really can feel the threat, because that's the closest we got to Afrin. You can feel that people are scared, because especially somewhere like Minbij, they obviously had the regime, they had al-Nusra, they had Daesh, and then they had the liberation by the Syrian Democratic Forces. And they're scared. They're scared that the next people to come would be the Turkish army. So they are scared, and which is why that was the only place that when we were entering the building of the assembly, the car we were in was scanned for car bombs. So they are taking the precautions as well, but obviously, as Simon and Lloyd have mentioned, they have no chance against airstrikes. So I think when he gave that answer, that's what gave me hope, because I thought to myself, if this revolution and therefore this movement can win over people like Fuad, who was an Arab tribal leader, you know, in Syria, if you're an Arab tribal leader, the world is your oyster. He could have anything he wants, but he chose to abandon what would come with being a tribal leader in that region, in that area, but serve the revolution and try and construct the system. Because one of the other things he said as well, he said, because he was one of the first people who rose up against Assad in 2011, and he said, when we managed to liberate the area, you know, with the SDF, we said education before bread. So yeah, obviously people weren't, they, you know, they were giving people bread, but you know, in the sense that the biggest focus, because everyone has mentioned the, you know, education, the biggest focus all across Rojava is education and transformation. Mm-hmm. And I think that is perhaps the biggest difference between any revolution that has happened in history and Rojava, because where it differs and therefore where its uniqueness and its success comes from is the method in which it's applying this revolution and therefore trying to transform society. And that's why, you know, I think it's really important that Janet mentioned that there is, they talk about no revenge, but there is, but they always talk about, this is actually how the Kurdistan Workers Party started. It was a revenge offensive, but not in a violent sense, but they said after Haki Karen, which was one of the founders of the movement, was massacred in North Kurdistan, in Turkey, they said that our biggest revenge is to have our founding Congress and establish this movement. And that's, I guess, exactly how they are actually taking revenge. They are taking revenge by making sure that this revolution is successful and that they are transforming society. And they do this through constantly and tirelessly trying to convince people, convince women and men and youth and everyone around them. And this is why I think ideologically and systemically this revolution is undefeatable. Unfortunately, there's a huge and a very real military threat by the Turkish state, and obviously Turkish state-supported jihadi groups. But in that sense, and this is why I think the biggest self-criticism that I had for myself when I came back is, I always thought I understood what struggle was, but I really didn't. Because here, and again, everyone in this room today, it's amazing that everyone's come, but unfortunately, a lot of us that come to these kind of events, we really come to just consume information, but not to give anything back. And we really have a huge consumer culture in all across the UK where we want to consume information, we want to consume products, we want to consume life, but we don't necessarily think that it's our old duty to also produce that in return or give that back in return. So, you know, obviously my message would be for people, take this information and please really do something about it and not just see it as information but also see it as a feeling too. And that's also one of the uniqueness. And I think, you know, I've never had the privilege to meet Anna Campbell, but from everyone who's spoken about her, she really understood what it was to struggle in a way where, you know, to contribute to constructing something and transforming something rather than expecting to come to ready-made revolution or ready-made anything. And therefore, through that, I think, through the idea of struggle and the method, someone asked me, I was at How the Light Gets In Festival last weekend, and weirdly enough, I was on the same panel as a Tory MP. And he spoke to me, he said something about, but you know, it might be okay now, but what about when the fear that unites all of these people is gone? And I said, actually, these people are not motivated by fear. They have broke down the empire of fear that is capitalist modernity and are motivated by hope for a better life. And hope that this life will also improve, that this alternative will also improve their lives, because which is one of the myths of capitalism, is that there may be alternatives possible, but those alternatives will never improve people's lives and therefore will not be productive. But that's the biggest example that Rojava shows to the world, is that actually this revolution does improve people's lives and is very productive. And we saw, and I'm so glad that Simon and Lloyd both mentioned the example of Kobane, because that was the most remarkable thing to me, that the city, after a few years on, is more or less completely rebuilt. And that's what the productivity of this revolution is that the only places that are still destroyed is places that they've deliberately left because they want to turn into an open-air museum. But, you know, they're working like a beehive all around the Democratic Federation of Northern Syria, and that's exactly where people are given their power and autonomy back. That's exactly the productivity that you see from it, is that people want to do things, and the myth that you know, humans are naturally competitive and therefore need like some overarching system to make sure that they are not savagely killing each other is completely destroyed in Rojava. You see that what we thought for such a long time as I guess radical thinkers is that humans are naturally cooperative. They naturally cooperate. And I saw this. One of the things I was expecting to see when I saw there was a bit more tension between Kurds and Arabs, and I didn't see that. So I was really pleasantly surprised. Maybe that's also something I need to deconstruct as well as to why I thought that. But I saw just how well these people are working together. And they joke with each other, but there is no tension that is a risk to the revolution or to the system in any way, shape, or form. The only risk, and as mentioned, and that needs to be emphasized constantly, is from the Turkish state and the Turkish army, because in Kamishlo and in Kobani, it's right on the border. And I think, you know, one of the things I want to conclude on is that the Rojava revolution, and therefore the invasion of Afrin, and why the international community was so silent, is that literally in Afrin, but also, you know, the wider northern Syria region, there is a clash of civilization. It's the clash between capitalist modernity, which is what we have here, and democratic modernity, which is what the revolution is. And the threat of a good example, so a revolution actually working, is exactly what the international community doesn't want. And it's a real example of neo-imperialism, where let's use these people who are good fighters, who are determined, and they don't feel used because obviously they're building their system, but I'm just talking about the approach. Let's use these people to kind of cleanse our name, that we can defeat the evil of the world, but then let's leave them because obviously we can't allow their system to work. And that's exactly what's happening right now. And therefore, it's even more important to understand the system, but more so actually to understand the idea of the way these people and this movement is struggling, and therefore in its methods in which it's building what it's trying to build. Because what it's trying to build, in its method in building that, it embodies just that, is that it's obviously a radical democracy with ecology, with women's liberation at its center. And the way it's trying to build, because there's no end product, it's not trying to get somewhere. The way it's trying to build its society is exactly, in a way, what the end product is. It's the method, which is the revolution. So, of course, I would urge everyone to go out there, you know, on delegations. You can also go out there for longer. The Internationalist Commune of Rojava, it can be a home to anyone. I got to meet people from all over the world who have been there for, you know, from 6 months to a year to 18 months, who are building the commune there as well. But also, I think, you know, I would urge people to go out there, but also we really need to be talking about it here, because there, and I know I've been repeating myself, but there is a real, real threat. And the biggest hope we've had for humanity in a very long time is at risk, and especially after the comments of Theresa May essentially labeling 40 million Kurds as terrorists. I think that's a real indication of where they're trying to take this, and we can't make any mistake, and we can't allow it to get to a stage where we said, oh, we should have done that. We need to do it right now. We need to be struggling with each other against the people we're supposed to be struggling against, but also within each other as well, and trying to transform transform our understanding of the world and our civilization. And therefore, I would say again, I want to end on again talking about Afrin. And Afrin was one of the most peaceful, was the peaceful city of the Democratic Federation of Northern Syria, home to, you know, between 800,000 to 1 million people. now it's been invaded by the Turkish army with jihadi forces, and unfortunately there's basically no talk about it. You know, this is a very, very significant genocidal invasion. You know, we have, and all of this is connected, the Afrin invasion with Brexit, with post-Brexit trade deals, all of this happening all around the world is connected. So therefore, we need to understand that we all have to, it has to be personal to all of us as well, because the society that unfortunately this government is trying to build in the name of post-Brexit economy or whatever they're calling it is directly connected to what they're still doing in the Middle East as well. And obviously that's not just Kurdistan, that's in Yemen, that's in Libya, that's in Palestine, that's all around the Middle East, but also all around the world. And these are all interconnected. And as long as we unite against the fascism of the states, they are actually a lot weaker than we think they are. Thank you.